this forum for interdisciplinary studies. Before I hand over the stage to Professor Shishir Roy, just a few words of introduction to the forum. This forum actually originated primarily because of an exchange of emails that Professor Roy and I had, which started with him posting a paper to a few of us in the institute, which basically highlighted how different approaches could be used to address certain problems, either in physics or biology. This was a problem in biology that he was talking about, and I wrote him a mail saying, why don't you give a talk on this field, and I think it'll be very nice because NIAS would like to do interdisciplinary studies and this could be a good starting point. And that's when he and I, through another discussion, decided that it would be nice to open up, establish a forum for interdisciplinary studies and open it up to various institutions in Bangalore and perhaps even outside so that we could have a larger audience discussing some of these important issues. Now, I just wanted to make three points about the goals of the forum. The first is, of course, to encourage interdisciplinary dialogue, discussions on various themes, and that includes both the natural sciences, the social sciences, the humanities, whatever your interests lie. Of course, the initial concept note that we circulated is biased a bit towards the natural sciences, primarily because of Professor Roy and our and my own restricted viewpoint and our ignorance about other fields perhaps. But this we would like to invite. It's a forum for everyone. We would invite all of you to contribute your ideas about what are the possible subjects we can take up, topics that we can discuss, and how we can take that forward. The second point I wanted to make is that along with this, we thought it would be nice to set up a kind of a digital library, which would have the talks that are being delivered, and in fact, we'll also have video recordings of this talk with the permission of the speakers, if they could give us a paper and perhaps interrelated papers or references that the speakers or the audience could contribute to the theme, we could perhaps build up a small digital library which we can host on our own website and which should be readily accessible to all and which could serve as the basis for further discussions. And the third and the most important objective we thought, and this is something that Professor Baldev Raj, our director, also brought up, is could these discussions be a starting point for some interdisciplinary work in these areas. Now, so we thought that was an excellent idea, and we therefore depend now on the speakers as well as the audience to see if certain lines of work could be opened up in the course of these discussions, which can be participated in by anyone who's interested, so that we can perhaps push the frontiers and establish a more active kind of a forum for perhaps more original work. But that is something that can evolve over time. So with that words, I would like to request Professor Shishir Roy to take over. Just one interesting comment, of course, when we thought of the title, we said Forum for Interdisciplinary Studies, and it looked like a fist. It sounded like a fist, and that's what we did, right? But today I got a mail from, we both got a mail from a close colleague of ours, who's also a research scholar in the institute, Mr. Murali Murthy. And he said, why don't you call it the Forum for Interdisciplinary Research and Studies? So it becomes FIRST instead of FIST, which I thought was an excellent idea. And since I just mentioned the idea of having some interdisciplinary research emanating from these discussions, we might just change the title to FIRST if Professor Roy feels that's acceptable. Thank you.
Thank you, Anindo, for a good introduction regarding concept note and our motivation. We have selected Professor Sebastian from IISc because he is a noted scientist, and he is professor and JC was fellow of Indian Institute of Science and also chairman science education panel Indian Academy of Sciences. So for the first lecture, we have chosen an emerging field called quantum biology, and in various phenomena like photosynthesis, what he is going to tell today. Others are like navigation of birds or theory of smell or dynamic of ion channel, there are several non-trivial phenomena people have found it seems that usual classical type of physics may not be useful. Instead of that, you may need quantum principles to understand these phenomena. So now a new field is emerging, and if you look at the Nature news, this is 2011, the Nature published Dawn of Quantum Biology. So it's an emerging field, and we think, in Bangalore, let us take a lead and put a seed of this type of ideas so that young, bright people may collaborate with senior people. So now, let us welcome Professor Sebastian to give his talk, and maybe, if possible, in more, not more technical language, because we have many, many people from various disciplines. They may not be acquainted with much quantum theory or coherence. So, he is an expert, so he can tell you more simple way. Professor Sivas.
Okay, good afternoon. I'm very happy to have been asked to give this talk. Essentially, first talk in a new forum. Although I really doubt my abilities to convey the ideas to all of you, because this is a little bit technical, unfortunately. I'll try to make it as simple as possible, and let us see. So the title is actually Coherences, Photosynthesis, and Quantum Biology. We became interested in this essentially because of some experiments that were done around 2008, which suggested that coherences are actually very important in the process of photosynthesis, at least in some organisms. So if you look at these leaves, actually there is photosynthesis happening because they are in the sunlight, and then the suggestion is that there is quantum mechanics, quantum phenomena are extremely important for this process. There is actually no evidence that it happens. Quantum mechanics is important in these leaves, but there is definitely evidence. So essentially the question is this wave function and the associated things important? You can put the question in a different, slightly different way. Do biological systems actually perform this process of quantum computation? And the answer at the moment, actually, there is experimental evidence that at least these systems do make use of quantum mechanics. And these are organisms which are called the green sulfur bacteria. They live in an environment in which light is very scarce. So they will get a photon, a particle of light, maybe once in a blue moon, maybe once in half an hour, and therefore it is imperative that it captures that photon. And the suggestion is that these organisms actually make use of quantum mechanics and makes the process more efficient, as a result of which they are able to catch the photon. So here is an outline of my talk. Of course, I outlined what the problem is. Then we'll talk a little bit about coherences, because I know that the audience is definitely mixed. I tempted to ask the question, how many physicists? Okay. So you have coherences. I'll explain very quickly what is meant by this. Then you will see that, you see, if you have systems in which you produce coherent excitations, I'll show them, and put them in close contact with the environment, there is the process of destroying of this coherence, which is referred to as decoherence. In particular, I shall talk about this system, FMO photosystem. This is actually the photosystem of that bacterium which I showed you. FMO stands for Fenner, Matthews, and Olson. It is just the names of the people who determine the structure of that photosystem. I'll talk a little bit about the experimental observations, not much, and of course it gets a little bit more technical. I shall talk about what people, physicists, would refer to as a Hamiltonian. I have to confess, I'm not a physicist, but I'm a chemist. How to do the time evolution. Don't worry about this. I try to make it as simple as possible and talk about our own approach to the problem. And talk a little bit about decoherence and population relaxations. And then, of course, I shall summarize the thing and conclude. So what is the problem? Well, this is the photosystem of green sulfur bacterium. It is not necessary for you to know all the details. All that you have to understand is that this portion is an antenna. Whatever photons come by, it will just capture that. And those captured photons, the energy is actually transferred to this. If you look at this, you will see that there are three of them. One unit has three subunits. And that is actually what is referred to as the FMR complex. This part is referred to as the chlorosome. Then you have the FMR complex, which is a trimer, as I said. So photons are absorbed by this part, and then that energy is transferred to this FMR complex. And from the FMR complex, a little bit detail. If you look at one of the monomers of this trimer, you will find that there are 7 chlorophyll molecules sitting in there. That's why a chemist is interested in this. And the energy is taken to one of these units, and then from there it is passed on to the reaction center, and further process happens. We will not be concerned about the other processes. All that we are concerned about is the process of energy transfer within one of these monomers. So if you look at one of them, as I told you, it is a trimer, but if you looked at one of them, you will find that there are 7 chlorophyll molecules. Each one of them, you can see 7 molecules here. Each one of them is a chlorophyll molecule. And what happens is that, you see, the energy is, remember, the energy is coming from above. And the energy usually is passed on to this chlorophyll. That is what we believe.
And then the energy actually, this is the traditional picture, and it jumps from here to there, from there to there, perhaps eventually reaching this chlorophyll, and then it is given to the reaction center. So what is happening? The energy is actually jumping. The traditional picture, energy is jumping from one chlorophyll to the next. I will say energy is jumping from one side to the next to the next. So an analogy would be to say that, okay, this is energy. But if the system obeys,
so the another possibility is, you say, instead of having a particle like behavior, your excitation can, if you think of quantum mechanics, the excitation moves as a wave. So essentially the excitation gets delocalized, if you are familiar with quantum mechanics, and then of course you will see that it goes back and forth. So therefore, this is the suggestion. The suggestion is that it is not the traditional picture of hopping from one side to the next, that is actually valid, at least in some systems. Suggestion is that it moves like a wave, and this motion as a wave actually is supposed to make the process more efficient. And this wave-like motion is a result of what are referred to as coherences, and so that is why coherences appear in the title of my talk. And therefore, one says that, you see, this process, for the process of energy transfer within the photosystem, coherences are extremely important. So what are coherences? Well, this is a little bit technical. I would try to make it as simple as possible. Coherences are responsible for this wave-like motion. So the idea is that, you see, for a quantum system, depend upon some knowledge of quantum mechanics, you have 2 possible states of the system characterized by psi1 and psi2, some wave functions, psi1 and psi2. And the nice thing about quantum system is that they are linear. And if they are linear, a sum of psi1 and psi2 also is a possible way for the wave function to be. So, and this is usually referred to as superposition. Psi1 is one possible function, psi2 is the other. You add the two, that also is a possible state of the system. People refer to this as superposition. But then, of course, you see, to get the physically meaningful things, you will think of the square of psi1 to the superposition, and then obviously, if you had the square of this, you will see that when you take this, the magnitude, and square it, you will see that there will be psi1 square, there is psi2 square. But then you will also have these cross terms. psi 1 star, star means complex conjugation, psi 1 star psi 2 and psi 1 psi 2 star, these are what are the lattice coherences. So if you did not have these two terms, you see, you will not have that kind of oscillations happening in quantum mechanics. So again, I have to think of, let us say, some atom, let us say, just to illustrate the point, think of an atom. Maybe the simplest thing is to think of a hydrogen atom. It has states which are called S orbital, so it has a wave function which is corresponding to this orbital. It also has a PZ orbital, and then what you can do is, this is a possible state of the system, that is another possible state of the system, so you can add the two up. So you can say, remember I had psi 1 and psi 2, instead of that I am specifically saying, think of an atom, not necessarily hydrogen atom, but some atom, and it has a possible state which is usually referred to as an S orbital, and an orbital which is referred to as PZ. And if you added the two up, what I have told you earlier implies that this is a possible state of the system, and then how will I represent it? Well, S orbital is usually represented by this, P is represented by this, so if you combine these two, you are going to get something in between. So therefore, this will be an appropriate representation, but this is at a particular instant of time, and as I said, it is not necessarily the, I am not thinking of a hydrogen atom, so S and P is it usually would have an energy that is different, and therefore there is an energy difference delta E between the two. And so if you start with this, what will happen is that you will find, I mean, quantum mechanics, or even experimentally, of course, you will find that these wave functions actually exhibit oscillations. And the frequency of these oscillations actually depend upon the energy difference between these two states. If you say delta E is the energy difference, then the frequency of the oscillation is actually equal to delta E divided by the Planck's constant, which is H. So this is essentially standard quantum mechanics, simple quantum mechanics, so to say. But now imagine I have an environment, you see, this is actually, if I had taken the atom in space, and if I had prepared that, this is what will happen. But imagine this atom is not in free space, but imagine it is in an environment with which it is interacting. So naturally, what would you expect? You know, I mean, if I have an oscillation and if I allow that to interact with the environment, the oscillations will, of course, die down. So that is what I shall refer to as decoherence. The coherent oscillations will actually die down. So just as an example, which can be experimentally studied, you think of an electron. I won't go into the details. The idea is that you can put an electron in water, and if the electron gets forwarded, that means the water comes and arranges around it, and you have what is referred as a hydrogen electron, and then you can excite this electron and put it into a coherent state. So this is a photon, this light that is interacting with it, and you create this kind of excitation material. So a coherent state you can prepare, and then of course this is exactly what I was talking about earlier. You can have these two things added up. Okay. So this is the superposition, though. This is usually referred to as superposition, S plus P is it. So I have just added the two states together, that's a superposition. Earlier what I was saying was that, you see, this was in the vacuum, in the isolated, but now you have the environment. So the psi, so you have a wave function characterizing the surroundings. So then this is how things are going to be. Your system is interacting with the surroundings, and what happens, you see, the oscillations earlier, if it was completely free, if it was isolated, of course, you can never have completely isolated system, but let us not go into that. If the system was interacting with the surroundings, these oscillations will die down. You can see that the oscillations actually have only a finite lifetime. And that is what we say is caused by the process of decoherence. Just to illustrate, if you had a hydrated electron, this decoherence actually is extremely short. When I say extremely short, what do I mean? Well, I am wandering away. When I say it is extremely short, you see, it takes a time of the order of 4.5 femtoseconds if it was a hydrated electron. Femtosecond is 10 to the power of minus 15 seconds. Okay. So therefore you would realize that this is extremely fast, 10 to the power of minus 15 seconds. On the other hand, instead of a hydrated electron, you can have dye molecules, don't worry about what they are. But you can excite them, you can put them into coherent superpositions, and then you will find that this is the experimental result. It is for this dye, the decoherence happens in 6.8 femtoseconds, betaine 30 in acetonitrile, that is just a solvent for the dye, you find that it is 49 femtoseconds. And decoherence, actually, people have calculated the time scale of these processes for real systems, and they find that it is usually of the order of maybe 10 or maybe at the most 50 femtoseconds. So that is the experimental result, and these were obtained by these guys. I have taken this statement from an authoritative book on decoherence written by Schloss Hoyer. What he says is decoherence is similar to dissipation, but it is distinct and it is astonishingly strong and fast. It is quite fast, as you have seen. 4.5 femtoseconds is really a very short time. So unless your system is extremely well shielded from the environment, decoherence actually makes it very, very difficult to observe these effects of this coherence. Decoherence will cause the coherence to vanish almost instantaneously. Now, in this connection, I would like to also point out the following. You see, there is people have been trying to make use of quantum mechanics to do the process of computing. And in fact, this company, D-Wave, actually this information is a little bit old. I didn't get the time to look up what they have done recently, but this information that I'm telling you is around 2 years old. So therefore, they may have built a better computer than what I'm going to say now. So they have made a computer which they claim has a quantum processes happening. It is referred to as the D-Wave. And if you look at the cost of it, this is 2 years ago, it was $10 million, and this is actually, the quantum computer makes use of not the bit, classical bit, but it makes use of quantum bits. And the computer that they made had only 512 such qubits, but the cost is actually $10 million. And this was purchased by NASA and Google together to do some computations using it. And the other thing is, you see, you have to keep it at near zero Kelvin. The computer has to be kept near zero Kelvin so that the quantum process will not die away. That means you have to keep the temperature so low that the environment, interaction with the environment is made as minimal as possible. Look at the size of it. It is 10 feet. That object that you saw is not like your laptop. It is 10 feet by 10 feet by 12 feet. Okay, so it is enormous in size, but in spite of that, if you look at the actual chip, the processor actually, the one that I have a picture of is only 128 qubits. It's only the size of a thumbnail. So the qubit, the processor is actually extremely small in comparison with the object in which it is housed in. And why is it that this object, you have to have this 10 feet by 10 feet by 12 feet sized object kept at near zero Kelvin? The reason is, this is the processor. Okay, it's very small in size, in comparison with the size of the actual system. So the reason is that, you see, you have to keep this very small chip isolated from the rest of the system so that quantum effects will not die away. So we have to do all these things. You have to isolate the system completely as far as possible from the surroundings. You have to keep it at near zero Kelvin. And generally, you will be able to make use of these quantum effects. And of course, there are people who still ask the question, is it really a quantum computer? But that is another question, because there is controversy saying that this is not really a quantum computer. You look at the biological system. The system that I have shown you, there is experimental evidence that there are coherences. Right? In the photosynthesis, there are coherences, and therefore it appears as if bacteria, even though we human beings have not been able to do any quantum computing, right? with such a system, or maybe it is done, but we have to be very careful. It appears as if that bacteria have been quantum computing for millions of years, and so therefore it appears as if you have non-trivial quantum effects, and they are seen in biology. And then of course, if they are seen in biology, we should be trying to understand them, and of course to make use of them. And this is one reason why this is actually referred to as the dawn of quantum biology. And as I told you, the experiments which demonstrated these coherences were done around the year of 2007. So since then, those experiments themselves have been referred to as the dawn of quantum biology. But of course, there are evidences from others. Experiments like what Professor Roy was mentioning. But I will be confining myself to only this process, because this is like the only system that I have studied myself. And then of course you have the question, is it actually, you look at the bacterium, it is in hot, humid surroundings. It is in water, at least, right? And it is in contact with surroundings. It is not at zero Kelvin, but it is at room temperature, or maybe near room temperature, okay. So then would you have coherences surviving for such a long time? What do I mean by surviving for a long time? There is experimental evidence that the coherences that are produced survive for about 600 femtoseconds. Not too much, only 600 femtoseconds. But we know that in such systems, decoherence actually happens in maybe at the most 10-20 femtoseconds. But the experimental observation is that there are coherences surviving in the system for 600 femtoseconds, which is rather long for such a system. And is that possible? Okay, this I don't think should be here, but anyway, because you see, people take these things to the extreme. And so there are people who, I actually wanted to remove this, I have forgotten. So, but anyway, you can read it through, and the people, whenever you have such a thing happening, then of course you will say that, okay, that is the evidence for an incredible design. I'm sorry that it is appearing here, but I didn't mean it to be there. But now you say, it is a little bit more chemistry and physics now. I'm assuming that you have been able to follow up to now. So I will, as a chemist, what did we do? We looked at the process. We tried to look at the process in more detail. So therefore, let me tell you, this is the system. I told you the FMA complex is a trimer, right? So you have three objects. This is why we say it is a trimer. And if you look at this, you see what you are seeing here are actually protein cover, right? You have protein cover, and within that protein cover, each one of them, you have 7 chlorophyll molecules. So these are the systems, 1, 2, 3. And the interaction between these two, they are fairly well apart. Therefore, it is believed that the interaction between these are not important. You don't have to worry about them. They are separate units. So inside them, you have closely packed bacterial chlorophylls. And of course, the environment is actually hydrophobic, which essentially means that you see what it is, water repelling. Water would not normally, you would not expect water to happily enter there. And the way they say the experimentalists, this is what they do. They take, they have numbered, there are 7 chlorophylls. They are numbered like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So remember, 7 is in the interior, and 3 is important. Why 3 is important? Because the energy is believed to reach there and then go to the reaction center. And the excitation energy from above, remember, energy comes from above, is passed on to either 1 or 6, because those are the ones which are closest to the antennae. So energy comes here or to there, and then it goes around. And as I told you, it is the process actually was believed to be jumping of excitation energy, but then it is probably moving like a wave, and that is why we are interested in this. Just to give you a little bit more technical detail, this separation between two chlorophylls is actually about 11 to 14 angstroms. And the molecule itself is about 12 angstroms, the size. Okay, if you look at a particular molecule, you see, as I told you, it gets excited. So what happens in that process, what happens is that there are electrons sitting in the molecule. And there are things which are referred to as highest occupied molecular orbital, lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. Essentially, what happens in the process of excitation is that an electron which was sitting in this state gets promoted to that. This state is empty, and that state has two electrons. I am not showing the electrons, but essentially one electron gets promoted from here to there, and that requires an energy which is of the order of, these are units of energy, 12,000 centimeter minus one. So essentially, you supply energy, the system absorbs the energy, and one electron is promoted from this orbital to that orbital. And that is actually of the order of 12,000 centimeter minus one. So, but then if you look at these chlorophylls, you see, they, in principle, they are all similar molecules, but you will realize that their environment, I mean, I have not shown the environment here, but this is covered with a protein. So the environment you would have seen is different. It is not the same for all the chlorophyll molecules. So what does that mean? That actually means that the excitation energy of one would be different from the excitation energy of six, because the surroundings are different. So if you arrange the excitation energies in the order of increasing energy, this is how it would be. Sixth molecule, which is here, will has the highest excitation energy, then that is followed by the second. This is actually the environment has tuned these excitation energies. And if you look at this, you would realize that it is the third molecule that has the lowest, and that is convenient and nice. That is a, I mean, apparently that is what evolution has done, because energy eventually has to reach here to be passed on. So therefore there is a hierarchy in the energy, excitation energies. So if you absorb, if the sixth molecule absorbs energy, it will pass it on to five. Remember, excitation energy of five is slightly lower, and so that the energy can be passed on very easily. From 5 it goes to 4, which is not surprising because they are nearby, but the energy wise also it is quite favorable. It is not the case that 4 has a higher excitation energy than 5, in which case the process will not happen. So it goes to 4 and then it goes to 3. That is how the energy, so therefore the environment actually is tuned so that energy can be passed on very easily to the molecule 3, and from there it is passed on to the reaction center. Okay, this is something that again one should notice. The energy separation is 11 to 14 angstroms. Okay, this is even more technical, unfortunately. Now, how does one study this kind of thing? I'm being a theoretician, I look at the process theoretically, I don't do any experiments. So, each one of these chlorophylls has the possibility of getting excited. And as we have seen, the excitation for each molecule is different. So therefore, what would I say? Okay, I have the jth molecule that would have an excitation energy of which I may denote as epsilon j, and this is going to be different for different molecules. So therefore, because I have 7 molecules, this j will run from 1 to 7. So this is usually referred to as excitons. The excitations are referred to as excitons. So there are 7 possible excitons in the system, molecular excitons. Excitons or excitations which are localized on each one of the molecules. And then once you put an excitation here, it can actually jump from there to there. And that is actually referred to as hopping. So the excitation which is put here can be passed on to there. And that is referred to as hopping. In quantum mechanics, there is the thing that is referred to as the hopping matrix element, which is denoted by the symbol Vij. So how does the hopping happen, and typically what is the interaction energy? The hopping matrix elements are actually written here. This is a, you can actually theoretically calculate what are referred to as the hopping matrix elements. Their values can be calculated. I'll very briefly tell you how they can be calculated. Here what is being done is actually the excitation energy of the lowest, which is the third site, is taken as 0, and the energies of the other sites are referred to with respect to that. So these things actually refer to the energies of the excitations, and these things, these off diagonal terms of this matrix actually tell you how the probability or the how the rate of transmission of energy will depend upon their interactions. And in fact, these Vijs are behaving like 1 by distance to the power of 3. The hopping matrix elements actually have an inverse r to the power of 3 dependence, where r is the distance between the two molecules that are involved in the hopping. This is a simplified slide. What happens is that in the process of hopping, excitation is passed from a donor to an acceptor. On the donor, you have an excitation, right? The electron, this, imagine this is an electron, that electron can be excited, so here I say the donor is excited. And that excited energy is passed on to a neighbor, which we say is the acceptor. So what does it mean? This electron will come down and that electron will go up. And what is the process that is responsible for it is essentially because of the fact that electrons have Coulombic interaction. So this electron would have its Coulombic interaction with the other electron, and what happens as a result of that Coulombic interaction, this electron gets de-excited and that electron gets excited. And this you can actually analyze the process and arrive at the result that the matrix element in this process has a 1 by distance to the power of 3 dependence. So if you say that this is your photosystem, you are going to excite one of the molecules and then this excitation energy is going to go around. Fine. Now, the most important thing is to take care of the environment. You have the surrounding, so you have to take care of the environment, and the usual thing that people would do is the surroundings is modeled as a collection of vibrations. So you have vibrations in the surroundings, you have to account for them. So the surroundings actually is taken care of as a collection of harmonic oscillators. So how does one take that into account? Well, see, if you think of the jth molecule, you have an excitation energy for that molecule. But once you say that it is going to be interacting with the surroundings, what will happen is that this excitation energy, because of the interaction with the surroundings, it will shift. So what will happen is that you see your excitation energy was epsilon j, but it will shift to epsilon j plus qj. So therefore that is the result of the interaction with the surroundings, at least one of the effects of interaction with the surroundings. So what happens is that each molecule, each chlorophyll has its own environment. So therefore if you have 7 molecules, you see they all fill different environments, so therefore each one of them would have its own shift, and not only that, when the surroundings is fluctuating, these things will also fluctuate. So therefore you have what is referred to as a coupling with the environment. So you have the excitation, so that is what is referred to as H electronic. This is your system, but then you have the environment. The environment is actually modeled as a collection of oscillators. So you have, that is actually referred to as H phononic, and then you have the coupling between the two, H electronic and phononic. Well, even more technical, so let me not even try to explain, but of course I need this, so therefore let me just tell you that this actually characterizes the coupling between the system, between your system. When I say system, that actually refers to this chlorophyll molecules and the surroundings. So therefore, it is a crucial thing as to how big these things are. These are usually referred to as a spectral density, and you will see that they play a crucial role in the process. Essentially, what it does is it measures the strength of the interaction of your system with the surroundings. Well, let me not worry about this. So you have to actually say that, okay, I will produce an excitation in one of these molecules, and then what will happen? Would it go around like a wave, or would it be jumping like a particle? And this is a fairly tough problem to handle. Why is it tough? Simply because, you see, this is not an isolated system. Your system is in contact with the surroundings, and not only that, the surroundings is at a particular temperature. So you have to look at the time evolution of a quantum system which is not isolated but is interacting with the surroundings, and surroundings is at a particular temperature. And what are the important things? You see, if I put an excitation here, it can hop. It can hop from there to there, as I told you, that is a Vij. Then you see, if you put an excitation there, that excitation will actually cause the environment to rearrange, and that rearrangement will cost energy, that is referred to as the reorganization energy. So therefore you have the hopping, you have the reorganization energy, and of course the energy, excitation energy on this side is different from the excitation energy on that side, and therefore you have an energy difference which is denoted by the parameter delta E. Usually in physics or chemistry, What happens is that these are the important parameters that characterize your system. You look at them and you ask the question, what is a small parameter? And then what you do, you try to build a perturbation theory around that, assuming that one of them is small. But in this case, what happens is that Vij, delta epsilon and this lambda, these are the parameters of the system. None of them are small in comparison with the other. They are all of the same order. And therefore, if you wanted to do a perturbation theory, it is not possible. At least with these parameters, you cannot do that, and therefore you are worried. I mean, you have to do something better. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. These parameters which characterize your physical problem are comparable and therefore rather difficult. And people have developed very complicated approaches. For example, there are what are known as hierarchical equations, numerical path integrations. These are actually very tedious numerical procedures, and they have tried to analyze the system. But what we have done is we didn't want to do too much computing, and therefore we tried to develop an analytical approach, simple analytical approach, which I hope to explain in a few minutes. So you have excitations, you see, these are your molecules and you have excitations. Each one of these things have an excitation which is shown as this cloud around that. So what you can say is that, you see, these excitations actually can be combined together to get an excitation which is spread over all over the system, and this is a result of quantum mechanics. So these are referred to as the adiabatic states. So you can represent your original Hamiltonian in terms of these delocalized states. But these states, you see, because they are spread over the entire system, what will happen is that as the environment fluctuates, these are also going to fluctuate. So therefore, energies of these delocalized states will actually fluctuate. You see, because you have seven states which you are combining together to get states which are spread over, they are all going to fluctuate as the environment fluctuates, and these energy levels are fluctuating. That is why I have drawn these lines which go up and down. So therefore, we can express your original problem in terms of these states which are fluctuating. So therefore, this is actually adiabatic part of the Hamiltonian, but you see, the fluctuations of the environment and the fluctuations of your system, they don't really completely follow one another actually well, and therefore you have non-adiabaticity happening. I shall just refer to those things as H non-adiabatic. And these are terms which are very interesting, because actually they are the ones actually transfer the system from, if the system is in this state, these things actually transfer it from there to there. Okay, in this picture. So they actually cause transitions between energy levels. I have already introduced this actually. The original experiment is what they did is they modeled this spectral density by such a term. Lambda is the reorganized energy that I have already introduced, omega z is a cutoff energy, and so on, and this would have that kind of shape. And incidentally, though, because I have introduced these parameters, you would be interested in their magnitudes, and so I have given the numbers that the experimental is actually used. It is 35 centimeter minus 1, and this cutoff is actually 50 femtoseconds. Now what would we like to have? I am skipping lot of technical details. We would like to have a simple approach. We would like to understand why coherences are long-lived. Essentially what it means is coherences are lived roughly up to maybe 600 femtoseconds. One would like to understand that. What is the role of environment in the process? Well, this is something that I will not talk about, correlations with the bath. Then can you have a theory which will be useful for bigger systems? These are the requirements that we put, and of course we would like our environment to be realistic. So let me just tell you the results. See, what we are saying is that, imagine the excitation is initially put on this particular site, which is site number 1. Molecule 1 is excited, let us say. We can do experiments with that. You excite the molecule number 1, you notice that the temperature is low, 77 Kelvin, and then you ask what is the probability that the excitation will survive on that site. I mean, you have 7 molecules, you excite one of them, After some time you ask what is the probability that the excitation is still there and not anywhere else. If you do a theoretical simulation, you will find that the result is actually given by this curve. So these points that are put are results of a simulation, numerical simulation, which looks a large amount of computing. Actually they are done by numerical path integration, which I will not go into, but technically it is quite a difficult thing to do, and you will see that there are oscillations, right? As you can see, the probability of finding the system on site, excitation on site 1 actually oscillates as a function of time, and you can see that the oscillations continue up 600 femtoseconds, right? This is what you will see. And not only that, there are oscillations, but not only that, you have put it on site 1, but then this is the excitation can pass on to which is this site, I think it is site number 2, yeah, this one. So this is the probability that the excitation is found on site 2, assuming that the excitation has happened on site 1, you will find that that also is oscillating. But at the same time, you will also find that there is a probability that the excitation can be passed on to site 3, which is the important site, and you will see that it is increasing. So the points are actually, you can say they are either the experimental results or the results of the simulations, and the two are in very good agreement, and the full curves that I have shown here are our theoretical results, which are in very close agreement with the experimental as well as numerical simulation results, and you can see that our theory works quite well. That's the essential point. We have developed a theory and the theory works quite well as far as the system is concerned. So therefore a good agreement with the exact results of Nalbach and numerical results and with the experimental results. Now, just to remind you how the system is numbered, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. 7 in the middle, 3 is the reaction center. Okay. Now suppose you say you look at the system, you will find, if I had given you the Hamiltonian which essentially tells you the interaction between the different sites, you will find that sites 1 and 2 are interacting very closely with each other. So if it is not surprising that if you put an excitation on site 1, it will pass on to the site 2. And similarly the other sites 6, 7, 3 and 4, 5, they are also are interacting very closely, but the coupling between 1 and 6 or between 2 and 7 is rather big. So therefore you see it is as if you have two independent systems, 1 and 2 are coupled and these 5 are closely coupled and the interaction between them is not large. So therefore if you forgot the environment, suppose the environment is not there, then you will find that there are oscillations between, there's transfer between 1 and 2. Essentially, if I put energy into 1, it will go to 2 and then it will come back. Quantum mechanical oscillations. And similarly, if I put it on 6, it will go around and then eventually come back to 6. This is what will happen if you had no environment. You can do this, these are curves, I mean, don't worry about them, but essentially what it says is that if there is no environment and if I put the energy into site number 1, it will go to 2 and come back, essentially executing oscillations. And you will also find that, you see, it doesn't go to 3. Remember, 3 is the important site. So it doesn't go to 3, it oscillates between 1 and 3 if I didn't have the environment. But then you can do a calculation, because you see, you are doing theory, so you can do things which the experimentalist cannot do. What I can do is, I can actually say, okay, I would just put in the effect of decoherence. I don't put in the other effects. I will just put in the defect of decoherence, then what happens is that the oscillations actually die down. But the population, the energy transfer doesn't take place to site 3. This is the site 3. You will see that there, even the previous slide, there were oscillations. The oscillations continued forever, but then when I put the environment, the oscillations actually die down. But there is no transfer to site 3. But then when I put the effect of that non-adiabatic matrix, non-adiabatic terms, actually you have population transfer, and then you will see that, okay, this is the proper calculation where you put all the effects in. Then what happens is that you see, you find that there is energy transfer to site 3. What does it say? It actually says that population relaxation, which is actually caused by those non-adiabatic terms, they are the ones that are responsible for energy transfer to site 3. What does it say? It is actually, see, if you have a system, normally if the energy, there is energy transfer, you would expect that energy transfer is kind of hindered because of the interaction with the surroundings. But here is an interesting point. The point is that the environment, the interaction with the environment actually causes the energy transfer to happen to site 3. If it was not there, the energy would be restricted to oscillate between 1 and 2, but the interaction with the environment actually is responsible for energy transfer. So therefore one would say that the environment actually assists the energy transfer to site 3. Okay, I am almost near the end of my talk. Now the, I gave you the spectral density that I had used in the calculation. These were actually done by the, given by the externalists. The spectral density that was used in the calculations till now were the ones that were given by externalists. But there are people who do molecular dynamics simulations on the system. So they will take the whole system and do molecular dynamics. And from molecular dynamics actually you can estimate the couplings. And these are the actual couplings which were estimated by the people. These are not experimentalists, but these are theoreticians. They give an expression. See, the what the experimentalists did is for each side they said the coupling is the same to make things simple. But simulations can give you detailed couplings for each side. You can have a coupling, and therefore they had a rather complicated simulation which will run forever, almost ever, for a. For a person who does analytic theory, and they could estimate these couplings, and then these were available. So these, because these couplings were reported, we did a simulation using those couplings. And when we do that simulation, we find that you see there is no oscillations. With those couplings, we find that the oscillations, these are actually, it's the same kind of curve. You have put the acceleration on site 1 and you ask whether there are any oscillations, you find that they are not there. If there is anything, you see the oscillations are not there, or maybe if you can say, okay, there are oscillations perhaps, but they will die down in 100 femtoseconds, not longer than that. Or you can ask, why is it so? The answer is here, actually in this slide. These are the couplings that were obtained by the simulations, while the experimentalists, what they did was they used a coupling which looks like this. This curve is the coupling that were used by the experimentalists to reproduce their experiments. Therefore, what you should realize is that this curve actually, we show that the magnitude of the coupling is very small in comparison with the similar couplings. And if you say that, okay, the coupling is very small, actually the oscillations will continue forever. So therefore, here is the summary and almost the end of my talk. This was a very interesting problem, and that is why we did these calculations. We wanted to have a simple approach. We have almost analytic coherences. Do they last for long times? Yes, the coherences are long lived. Well, our own conclusion is that, you see, if I used the couplings that were given by the experimentalists, who also did the simulation using a very complicated procedure, the actually coherences are long-lived. Does the environment play a role? Well, if I use that, of course, you see environment actually assists the energy transfer. This is something that I have not discussed, so I will not talk about it. Now, can the method be extended to bigger systems? Yes, it is easy. With our procedure, it is very easy to extend it. Can one take care of a realistic environment? Yes, it is possible. We took care of a realistic environment, and then we did not find coherences lasting for 600 femtoseconds, but instead we found that coherences would die down in about 200 femtoseconds. So therefore, you see, what is the conclusion? The conclusion, at least as far as we are concerned, is that the coherences that the experimentalists have suggested, they don't last as long as 600 femtoseconds. They last only for 200 femtoseconds. But of course, then there is this natural question, what is it that you see experimentally? The answer is that, you see, the experimentalists were suggesting that this electronic coherence, electronic excitations are, the coherences among electronic excitations are the ones that are important. But, I mean, our own work is published, I mean, about 2 years ago. There have been suggestions that it is not electronic coherence, and there seems to be more and more evidence coming up that it is not electronic coherence, but these are vibrational coherences. But that is another story, and I have not worked on that. There are others who have worked on that, so I will not go into the details of that. So it appears as if the coherences, I mean coherences are there, they are, they would last for up to 600 or even 1300 femtoseconds are there, actual evidence is there, but our own analysis suggests that these are not electronic coherences, but in all likelihood they are vibrational coherences. So this is just a summary, I have already talked about them, so let me not do that. I should acknowledge the people who funded it. Of course, I have been given a J.C. Bose fellowship, so therefore I have made use of that. Indian Institute of Science, of course, you see, it has no choice to support me until tomorrow, because I retire tomorrow. Okay. But of course, I will get my pension, and then of course, the Pallavi Bhattacharya is the person who did this work, my PhD student now. As I said, she finished about 1.5 years ago. She is a postdoc in Cornell and quite happy there. So I would like to thank you for your attention. Okay, let me know. Thank you. Yeah, well, I hope it was not at a too high a level. I have tried to make it as simple as I can. Thank you.
The environment, it's simply incorporated using a wave function, you do not put noise.
Oh, it is there in the environment. Noise is actually responsible for
no,
this.
Do you
set a temperature T, finite temperature, I am doing a finite temperature calculation. So therefore all the effects of the environment is there, noise is there.
So you explicitly put random noise? Or
no, we don't put it. We model it with the Hamiltonian.
That's what I asked.
So the Hamiltonian gives the noise, because if you put the Hamiltonian, I mean, so to say, Hamiltonian is put at the temperature T.
Okay.
Right? I mean, your system is put at the temperature T, all the effects, all the quantum effects, right, I mean, are there. Okay. And the noise from the environment is there. They are responsible for part of the coherence. But you see, because your system surroundings are quantum mechanical, you have to worry about the time evolution of the environment also. And you, when the time evolves, you see, when your system is time evolving, environment also evolves. And so therefore, you have to worry about the overlap of the environmental wave function with its own wave function and so on. And that is what causes the coherence. And that is all properly accounted for.
The other thing was, I was just wondering, why are you calling it adiabatic?
Because to work with this, you can make different, you can start with different kinds of wave functions.
Yes.
So the what traditionally people have done is each site, you have wave functions which characterize excitations on different sites.
Yes.
That is the traditional way. But what we have done is those functions have been combined together to get a delocalized state.
A mean field kind of a thing.
Okay, it is not really a mean field kind of approach, but you are saying, okay, the wave functions are delocalized, there are 7 of them.
Okay.
And okay, what you have to imagine is that as this, the environment changes, these things also change. Okay, that is why they are called adiabatic. If the environment was changing slowly, then they are exact eigenfunctions of the system. If they are changing very, very slowly, there will be the eigenfunction. So they are, that's why they are called adiabatic. And so we re-express our Hamiltonian, which was represented in terms of these sites. They were originally written in terms of site wave function. The Hamiltonian itself is re-expressed in terms of these states. And the nice thing is that once you do that, you see the corrections can be treated as a perturbation. I told you there is no small parameter. But once you do this, the corrections, you can identify perturbations, and therefore you can use perturbation kind of approach. That is the reason why it was done. And that is why we can do it analytically, otherwise you would not have been able to do it analytically.
So could you comment, you motivated this by talking about efficiency. So if I understood correctly, in the absence of any coupling to the environment, you're stuck in the first molecule that absorbed it. And somehow the environmental noise is what's causing it to go through. Presumably, in the limit of high noise, all the energy absorbed is released as heat. Is that the idea?
That's right.
And
is
so
that what you said is of course right. Now the thing is, if you look at the Hamiltonian, if I put excitation on this side, it will go to only that side. That is how the lowest limit. It will not go anywhere else. And the remaining things, again, if I put energy on this, it will just wander around that. It will not go to one on two. But what happens is that, you see, in our picture, you have delocalized states connecting one and two and the remaining. And then what happens is that when the acceleration gets delocalized, the environment actually causes a population transfer from this delocalized state to the other delocalized state, and that is responsible for the transfer. Therefore, environment actually assists. But in our picture, though I have not gone into the details, it's essentially population transfer that causes the energy transfer to that particular site.
And is there some notion of, could you quantify how much the efficiency gain is over some classical method of hopping?
No. I mean, that means I have to do a classical picture analysis and compare. No, I have not done it.
That's a suggestion.
I mean, our calculations actually suggest that it is not electronic. Because if it is electronic, we would expect that it will die down sooner. But then, of course, we have to qualify what I have said. So what have we done? We have developed Rodian and everything. We have taken the parameters that is given by the externalities, did the simulation. There were numerical simulations already available, and our analytical calculation compares with the numerical results very well. Then we took the parameters given by somebody else who has done a simulation, right? And the simulation gives you much larger values for these parameters. And if you put that in, then you would have coherence. But there is this question, are those simulations giving you the correct coupling? Regarding that also there is a controversy. So therefore, I mean, all that I can say is if you use that coupling, then I don't think coherence. Therefore, one has to actually look at the couplings very, very carefully to make sure that things are okay. I mean, I have met somebody who told me that those simulations are not correct. That's why I'm telling you this. You should go back with the correct information.
Experimentalists measure the coherence to differentiate classical and quantum coherence. There is no experimentally determined which is the classical coherence, which is quantum coherence. That's the debate.
Whenever you have phenomena, you would have coherence.
No, but is there any experimental method to differentiate that this is classical coherence measure, this is quantum, not theoretical background? This is the big question people are raising nowadays.
Never thought about this because I never heard this question. Interesting question.
No. Experimentally, from spectroscopic analysis, we are saying a coherence. But is there any method experimentally to determine which kind of coherence this is, classical or quantum? No. Answer is no. Not yet. So that's the big question people say, okay, classically you can do it.
Professor Apurva Patel, who says that you can have coherence, then you can use classical coherence to do computations and so on. He has done a paper on that.
Yeah, maybe it's a new field and there is a lot of scope for it.
No, I mean, I've never thought of this, so I don't have an answer at the moment. When I answer, you say it should be something sensible.
No, because in Jodhpur conference, a huge number of people came from experimental and theoretical sides. They're debating on the issue, and people, experimentalists, they say, no, we don't have any experimental demarcation that this is for classical coherence, this is for quantum coherence. Okay, I mean, thank you so much for giving.
I hope it was understandable.
You did mention in your slides that bacteria has been doing in a quantum way for the last few hundred million years.
Yes.
So the question is whether they are doing it or it is happening that way. I mean, we can say somebody is doing something when there is a choice. So is it that what is happening in this way and we are observing this way?
All that one can say is that there is actual evidence that it is happening. I don't know whether it is doing it or not, because I mean, I can give you a biologist's answer. I'm not a biologist, but evolution has done it. So if the bacteria which is living in such an environment, you see, Photons are very, very infrequent. As I said, you will get a photon maybe once in a blue moon. So to survive, it has to capture that. People who are bacteria which are not able to capture it will die. Therefore, it's selection.
But is all the bacteria that they see everywhere around the world do this?
I can only say experimental evidence. Experimental evidence is there for this bacterium. And in fact, there are suggestions that it is happening in higher organisms also. Some experimental evidence is there. But the major question for me is whether it is vibrational coherence or electronic coherence. And I suspect that it is not electronic coherence.